regret. Wandering God, can you forgive and forget? Bitter and broken, too blind to see. But mercy revealed, love's mystery.
Welcome into the program. Amen. It's testimony time. And hey, guess what? You can call in live right here tonight with me, your host, Evangelist Eddie Chaney. And you can share it live right now on the program. Just simply dial 1-931-484-4531. Or if you're not able to check in live, you can call the testimony line, a pre-recorded line. You get about 3 minutes to leave a short testimony or Bible question, a comment, or just shout howdy. We'd love to hear from you. You can dial 1-931-229-0768. And that's 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. You can share your testimony and help us let the world know that God's not dead. He's alive, amen, and lives forevermore. Tonight we got a couple things going on. We're going to give an update on Brother Jeff Murner. He's up here in Crossville Hospital in intensive care. We're still waiting to find out the determination about the heart. We did get to see him tonight. We did, amen. And he looked pretty good. He swelled some in the face. We're going to work on getting his cell phone time on it tomorrow. We're going to, we got to come up, get the card and get time and get it back up to the hospital tomorrow after I get off work. So we're working on that. Everybody's trying to pitch in and help do what we can for him as we continue to pray for him. Amen. First and foremost, that God take care of this and comfort him as he heals him. Amen. So be much in prayer for Brother Jeff Murmur, if you would, here in Crossville, Tennessee. Well, we're going to be right back. We got a lot of things going on. after this next song. We're going to start sharing some testimonies via the phone line, via the email. They've sent them to me and things and want me to share them. So we're going to try to do that. So be much in prayer for us tonight. And as always, if you call in, we'll stop the pre-recorded and let the live go forth, and then we'll go back to the pre-recorded line or the email. But it is testimony time. It's time to stand up and say, hey, I'm not ashamed to proclaim Jesus Christ in his holy and righteous name. We'd love to hear from you. We want to give you an opportunity that you can tell the world, yes, how good the Lord has been to you and your family. Tell the world where he brought you from and where he's got you. God's good, my friend. Don't be ashamed. Stand up and proclaim his holy and righteous name. Amen. That's what it's all about on testimony time. Be blessed, and we'll be right back. I am your host, evangelist, Brother Eddie Chaney.
Sunday morning, everybody gathered in the middle of the woods sat a little white church house, and it would fill up with family and friends. Then the bell started ringing and the choir started singing. The harmonies were sung to Jesus out in the middle of the woods. It was an ordinary Sunday. Everybody gathered in. Some were clapping their hands, some were tapping their feet, but everybody had their mind on him. Then the preacher preached the Bible. He preached the message loud and good. It was an ordinary Sunday out in the middle of the woods. How the Lord was so good, he was doing all he could. And in the house there was not a dry eye. When the roll is called up yonder, it will evermore grow fonder. Gathered in. Some were clapping their hands, some were tapping their feet, but everybody had their mind on him. Then the preacher preached the Bible. He preached the message loud and good. Sunday out in the middle of the woods, in the little white church house, out in the middle of the woods. It was an ordinary Sunday out in the middle of the woods.
Amen. All right, sit back. Be blessed as we listen to a testimony about how Jesus changed a man, listen, who tried to kill an entire family. So be blessed. God's not dead. He's alive and lives forevermore, my friends. Be blessed in Jesus' name.
April 3rd, 1986 was a big day that changed my life. In 1985, I drove a motorcycle under the influence and got into a traffic accident. I then went to prison. My wife asked for a divorce when I was released from prison, and I set up a thorough plan to kill 8 people. My wife, her family, even child relatives who encouraged her to get the divorce. The last thing I did before executing this plan was to meet my mother in Guangzhou. Then I booked a train ticket leaving for Seoul at 10:40 p.m., and it was the night of April 3rd, 1986. While I was at my mother's house, I heard a resonant voice that I've never heard before 40 minutes prior to getting on the train. It was so loud and thunderous of a sound that it almost split my ear. "Look, look," it said. Feeling too strange, I went out the front door and looked around, but there was no one. Second-guessing myself, I returned to the bedroom and I was about to light a smoke. Suddenly, the room became bright. I was surprised and looked at the bedroom door in the confusion of the moment, and at that instant, I yelled in shock. While a clear rainbow light was flowing down, there was something walking down in the light. Looking over it, it was a person who wore white clothing. Due to the bright light, I couldn't see its face clearly, but it was human-like. After a while, a rectangular horse-drawn carriage was following behind him. There were three seats on the carriage. The center one was empty, and two people wearing white clothing sat on both the sides. If someone who believes in Jesus saw the scene, he would have been touched greatly, but I was just stunned because I was an atheist man. A strange point I should add is that I felt my burning hatred disappearing. I woke up my mother, who was sleeping by me, but she didn't seem to see the scene, and she ignored me, saying, "Don't be ridiculous," then went to sleep again. When I looked back at the carriage again, I was startled. A person who looked like me was sitting on the center seat, which was previously empty. I touched him to make sure he was real. It was like I was looking in a mirror. As soon as I sat down on the seat, the carriage took off. After that, I got to clearly witness heaven and hell. After passing a dazzling and brilliant golden road, I passed by a place where people like me were walking along a flower garden road, smelling the flowers. I was able to see people came from all over the world. I clearly saw my uncle's face on my mother's side, who had been a Christian and died of a disease. However, I couldn't find any disease marks on him. His appearance looked like a youthful 30-something with a young face and body, similar to how I saw him when I was in the third or fourth grade in elementary school. Peace and happiness, absent of any anxieties and concerns of the world, was apparent on his face. Hearing a continuous booming musical sound, the golden carriage was passing by brilliant gold houses after driving for several days. When we arrived here, the angels, who wouldn't answer whatever I asked, eventually said, "Here is heaven," with a very clear voice. There were an uncountable number of houses which were stretched out into the horizon. A common point that I felt from those brilliant golden houses that I've never seen on Earth was that all of them were neatly organized and looked ready and waiting for an owner to move in. Unlike where my uncle was, I was unable to see anyone here. I asked the angels about it, but they didn't answer me. The carriage was suddenly entering a dark place as if it were night. The only source of illumination was a bright light the size of the full moon. It was in the shape of people wearing white clothing like those who drove the carriage. The music I heard before had already stopped. Fear entered my mind before I was aware of it. I was scared, thinking, now that they've showed me the most beautiful things that I'll never see on Earth, are they gonna kill me? A light, human-like shape was illuminating a person before I was aware of it. I got to witness my father, who had died 6 years ago. He was the breadwinner and took care of family matters. He successively held the position of a Confucian scholar principal. While he was alive, he issued an impetuous order for people to stop talking to him when he heard them say the J of Jesus. When this man was on his deathbed, he became miserable, and his body swelled so much it could burst. Now before me, I saw my father suffering from pains as if he were approaching death again. Blue, venomous serpents with triangular heads, enough to hide his ankles, were bloodying my father's body, crawling, wrapping around him, and biting him all over. I was crying in despondency and calling out to him, but he didn't seem to hear me at all. The second place I went to, a large number of people were gathered in a crowd trying to escape from a fire on an extremely huge iron plate similar to a grill. Simply, it was pandemonium. I met another acquaintance here. He was my father's older brother, who, having lived like a miser, said that money was everything. He was not able to hear my voice either. At the place spotlighted by the third light, I witnessed a friend who had died in a traffic accident.